The president did call Nancy Pelosi to congratulate her on the Democrats winning over control of the House. As you said, she is the likely incoming speaker. We don't know for sure. But the fact that the president called Nancy Pelosi is a strong suggestion that he knows where things are going. And we should also point out, Jake, in just the last few minutes, you were having that conversation just a second ago about what will happen when the Democrats officially take control of the House. Kellyanne Conway, the White House counselor, was out here briefing reporters just a few moments ago, and I pressed Kellyanne Conway on what's going to happen. How is this White House going to respond? Does the White House have a plan for what will happen when Democrats take control of all of those committees, have subpoena power, and ask for those tax returns, conduct other investigations? She did not answer that question, but she did say when I pressed her on this and what they're going to do, what the president will do, if Democrats ask for those tax returns, she said, quote, I guess they could try. Jake, as you were just saying a few moments ago, they're going to do more than just try. They're going to push this White House, and it could cause a very big clash between two big branches of government. One other thing I should point out, I talked to a senior Republican source close to the White House, close to Capitol Hill, who said the expectation is on the Republican side up on Capitol Hill is that all of this is going to be a, quote, major headache, not only for Republicans in Congress, but for this White House when Democrats take control of that House. This is something, Jake, as you know, during the campaign, President Trump refused to release those tax returns. Over the last 2 years as president of the United States, he has refused to release those tax returns. This is a major battle, a major fight to come between the White House and a newly Democratic House of Representatives come this January, Jake.
And thank you so much, Jim Acosta. And let's not forget that still hovering out there, and who knows what his schedule is, but perhaps he was waiting for the midterms to be over, is Robert Mueller, the special counsel investigating whatever happened or didn't happen with regards to obstruction of justice, any possible conspiracy with the Russian government. And now there is a body in Washington, D.C., a house the House of Representatives, a chamber in Congress that is eager to hear what he has to say.
And potentially make all that information public as well.
Oh, absolutely. And take action.
That's
so,
right.
You know, it's nice for President Trump to tweet a tremendous success. It's not a tremendous success, and he'll see that in the next few days.
Very soon. All right. I want to go back to Anderson. Anderson?
Hey, Jake Wolf, thanks very much. So, Abby, I mean, are we basically headed for just next 2 years of complete gridlock? And, I mean, the president, you know, congratulated Pelosi, acknowledging her call for bipartisanship, but does that seem less likely now?
Are we headed for complete gridlock? Probably. I think I'm old enough to remember when President Trump wanted to work with moderate Democrats on infrastructure, and that lasted for maybe 5 minutes. And part of the reason for that was because the president realized pretty quickly that it was more beneficial to him to fight Democrats. His supporters are motivated by that. They like to see him fighting for what he ran on. They like to see him going after these people who he has villainized on the campaign.
The same, though, can be said of Democrats. It benefits them.
I think that's exactly right. But from the president's perspective, is he going to want to compromise? I'm not sure that he will. I think he gets as much out of not compromising as he does, as he might get from compromising, if not more. And as we're going into a period of a lot of investigations and a lot of conflict from the investigative side on the Democratic side, the president is going to do what he does best, which is take it under. He has people, as Gloria knows, that have signed up to kind of run the fighting back part of this. But the president is going to be the one doing that. We saw it with Mueller. We saw it with the midterms. He takes it upon himself, and he's going to do it. He's going to do it by creating a foil out of the Democrats.
And obviously, the presidential race begins. You know.
Yes, and that will, well, probably there are a few hours before it starts, but very, very soon. Let me posit something, though, which is that in an odd way, there is an advantage here for him. On the whole, I think it'd be better for him to have the House. But one thing that having a Democratic House will do for him is prevent the Republican base from pushing him into taking positions that might make it even more difficult for him. You know, I think about I don't know how you guys feel about this. I actually think John McCain, when he turned his thumb down, may have spared him some problems here, because you look at how health care motivated Democrats. Imagine if they had taken the Imagine if the Affordable Care Act had gone down and the chaos that would have reigned after that. He has an excuse now for not doing some of the things that the base wants him to do if he wants to go that route.
I'll give you a couple things I think the president is going to try to do to attract Democratic votes. I think he's going to try to push for a paid family leave bill. That's something that is very high on his priority, something that that he would have trouble getting through a Republican House, that he can now get through a Democratic House and will have sympathy in the Republican Senate. So look for that as one bipartisan thing he can do. I wouldn't be surprised, knowing this president, he pushes for some sort of minimum wage increase. Again, another thing,
infrastructure.
It would be tied to something else, like an infrastructure bill. But there are plenty of opportunities. Donald Trump is not an ideologue. Donald Trump is for things that Democrats like. They just don't like him.
But just to make the point real quickly, Rick, I want to talk. That assumes that all the folks who just got elected to these House seats, you know, progressive people of color, right, to the left, far left of the speaker, well, are going to want to go along with it.
Let me say something about, those people.
They are.
Let me say a couple things about those people. A new generation of people is now a part of the American political process. A lot of younger people, a lot of women, a lot of people figured, hey, Hillary Clinton's going to win. Everything's going to be fine. They didn't work that hard. They spent the past 2 years in shock and upset, and they decided to get involved. And they didn't get everything they wanted, but they got a lot done. And I think that, you know, those forces now have been unleashed in the country. And I think they're more positive than negative. And so on issues like criminal justice reform, which is a big issue among this new mobilized base, they care about criminal justice. That's something this president has said some positive things about. There could be something there. I think you're seeing people, there's a new labor movement that is emerging out of the service sector, domestic workers, this idea of paid family leave. There could be some common ground. I don't want us to assume that this movement is only the resistance. They are not just the resistance.
But they're not going to walk away and be happy with an infrastructure bill.
I do think the Democrats have to show, if they're running the House, that there are things they want to do. And whether they can get Donald Trump to go along with it or not, I think remains to be seen, because we've seen him on both sides. The president has to be able to, say, work with them maybe on infrastructure or criminal justice reform, et cetera, and draw a line, because they are going to do everything they can to subpoena him and to push him up against the wall on all kinds of things like Puerto Rico, hurricanes. What happened in Puerto Rico? What happened with your border policy? We want to know how that unfolded. So they're going to be pushing him on one side. And I don't know that he's able to do both of those things at the same time.
Yeah, I think he is. And I think that you're going to see the big problem the Democrats are going to have is the same problem that Paul Ryan has. You're going to have your version of the Freedom Caucus. I don't know what you're going to call going to call them, the Radical Caucus or whatever you want to, you know, the Socialist Caucus, whatever it is, who are going to be dogmatic. And who are going to insist upon family leave.
If you look at the map, a lot of these Democrats who won in places that weren't terribly ideological and aren't going to necessarily go down that road. There's no doubt there's some caucus that is very dogmatic. I think it's more complex than that. I don't think it's like there's going to be the Democratic version of the Tea Party. I think you're going to find it's much more complex. There are new members who just got elected in districts that are newly Democratic districts.
So, Dave, you think there's going to be a resurgence in the Blue Dog Caucus is coming back?
No. It's not the Blue Dog. I think what David is saying is really important to pay attention to your point, Anderson, about the presidential election begins right away, because there is an immediate conversation now happening inside the Democratic Party off of these results tonight. Yeah. So when Van was talking before about the emotional pain he was feeling by not having Gillum or potentially Abrams or Beto O'Rourke, these were the folks that were the folks that were touching the zones in the base that was getting them really excited about reshaping what the future leadership of the party looked like. But actually, the people that won tonight, that created the Democratic majority, they won on Republican terms.
That's where this majority is coming from.
Not necessarily a Blue Dog
caucus. But that's not the majority in the caucus.
If you're Joe Biden, You are waking up tomorrow
right.
morning.
That was my point.
Feeling yeah, much good. Better about what you learned tonight about the Democratic Party than you were necessarily a couple months ago when you thought maybe it was going to be the Elizabeth Warren Party.
And this is, I think, why having somebody with the experience of Nancy Pelosi at the helm, who knows how to garner votes and count them, is going to be really important if there is going to be something done. I think she knows how to corral.
Deal with all those young whippersnappers.
She will. She knows how to do it. She's got the seniority and the experience at this time to be able to do it. I know she's controversial, and she's going to take all those incoming barbs, and the others are probably going to be glad that she's the one who's doing that. But she can corral votes.